Good evening, everyone. On behalf of the Harriman Institute, I am honored to welcome everyone here for a special evening commemorating the Dayton Peace Accord's 20th anniversary. My name is Alexander Alex Cooley, and I am the Harriman Director and a Professor of Political Science at Barnard College and Columbia University. Since its founding in 1946, the Harriman Institute has maintained its position as a leading center for the advancement of knowledge in the field of Russian, East European, and Eurasian studies, which we define quite broadly indeed, through the research conducted by its faculty, fellows, visiting scholars, postdocs, and the training of scholars and professionals. Part of our mission at Harriman is to hold programs that seek to create a forum for intellectual exchange and the further enhancement of our students and our community's education. So our program this evening is emblematic of Harriman's charge and is part of a larger conference on the Western Balkans, the 20th anniversary of the Dayton Peace Accords, Bosnia's Uncharted Future, and Balkan Lessons for Global Applications. Marking anniversaries has become a regular staple of what we do here at Harriman, but they also present, I think, a challenge, a distinct conceptual challenge. On the one hand, we want to take stock, sometimes even celebrate, a particular momentous event or turning point, but we also have a duty as a center of intellectual production to ask ourselves critically and honestly about what has followed and the unexpected impacts that have been felt subsequently. In short, we have to pose and try and answer the very difficult question, what have we learned? So in crafting a conference about Dayton, we at the Institute have been truly privileged to have Professor Tanya Domi in the driver's seat. And I want to take a moment to publicly acknowledge and thank her for just her tremendous leadership and efforts in this part. Since a few hours ago, when the conference began with the screening and discussion about the notable film Seeking Truth in the Balkans, and over the course of the next 24 hours, our faculty, visiting scholars, practitioners, and students are gathered to focus on the state of Bosnia-Herzegovina, which many believe has become a frozen conflict in its legal framework known as the Dayton Peace Accords. The objectives of the conference is to examine the legacies of Dayton for the region and analyze and recommend policies and practices that can potentially put Bosnia on the road to a sustainable democracy and vibrant economy. Secondly, the conference seeks to examine Dayton's legacies and how these dynamics can apply or rather become lessons learned for current post-conflict states or states currently in conflict. When you think about all the different fields that have been touched by the legacies of Dayton, political science, transitional justice, sociology, it's truly remarkable. So ever mindful of this dual mandate and purpose we have, I am truly delighted that we will be treated to the insights and understanding that Katsi Martin will share with us this evening. She is a noteworthy journalist and has combined a superlative, award-winning journalism career coupled with human rights advocacy. From 2003 to 2008, Martin chaired the International Women's Health Coalition, a global leader in promoting and protecting the health and human rights of women and girls. From 2001 to July 2002, Martin was chief advocate for the Office of the Special Representative for Children in Armed Conflict at the United Nations. From 2001 to 2011, she was a member of the board of Human Rights Watch. Martin is currently a director and formerly chair of the Committee to Protect Journalists. She also serves on the board of the directors of the International Rescue Committee and the New America Foundation, a public policy think tank. She is a member of the Council on Foreign Relations, Penn International, and the Authors Guild, and sits on the board of the Central European University. Since 1980, Martin has published 8 books and contributed as a reporter to ABC News, PBS, NPR, The New Yorker, Atlantic Monthly, The Times of London, The Washington Post, The Wall Street Journal, Newsweek, Vanity Fair, and The New Republic. From 1995 until 1997, Martin hosted NPR's America in the World, a weekly half-hour broadcast on international affairs. And from December 1977 until December 1979, Martin was ABC bureau chief in Germany. While based in Germany, Martin reported from Poland, Hungary, Italy, Holland, Northern Ireland, East Germany, and the Middle East. Prior to that, from 72 into 73, Martin was a reporter for NPR in Washington. In addition to diplomatic and public assignments, she was involved in development of NPR's famous program, All Things Considered. She has been the recipient of numerous awards for her writing, reporting, and human rights advocacy, including a George Foster Peabody Award for a one-hour documentary on China. She was a Gannett Fellow at Columbia University School of Journalism in 1988, and she received a Philadelphia Press Association Award for Best Television Feature Story and a PBS Award for reporting from China. In 1997, she received the Mark H. Tannenbaum Foundation Award for the Advancement of Interreligious Understanding and the Athens, Greece-based Kyriazis Foundation Prize for the promotion of press freedom. Most recently, the President of the Republic of Hungary awarded Martin the Commander's Cross of the Order of Merit of the Republic of Hungary. In 2007, the YIVO Institute for Jewish Research honored her with their special cultural award. In 2008, she was presented the Leadership Award for Media by the Mirage Foundation for the American Dream. In 2011, she was awarded the United Nations Association Leo Nevas Human Rights Award. Same year, she was named a Rockefeller Foundation Creative Arts Fellow, and in 2012, Martin was honored by CEC ArtsLink for her work Changing Global Perspectives. Martin has not only been a reporter and eyewitness to history, but she has thoroughly lived it too. Following Cady Martin's address, we will have a short question and answer with her. We get to our keynote speaker, we inaugurate the opening of the conference with remarks by His Excellency Harris Herle, the recently accredited Bosnia-Herzegovina's ambassador to the United Nations, who has come up from Washington, D.C. Ambassador, please.
Thank you, Mr. Cooley. Good evening to everyone. I had particular desire to be here with you this evening. I'm greatly honored to take part in your discussion about Bosnia and Herzegovina. I will frame a brief remarks with a few images which I believe may help balance the protocol requirements with my need to say a few words here this evening. First, the title of this event includes two words, Balkan or Bosnian's lesson for global application. I find it quite germane. With Bosnia on the verge of applying for EU membership, you are highlighting the broader relevance of the recent experience from the Balkans. You may wish to consider the premise that the Dayton constitutional framework is in effect a pure touch of globalism. Its assortment of checks and balances, compromise and consensus requirements amounting to an accelerated course in democracy that may have prepared the country for the ramifications of globalism even better than some EU member states. We certainly are not going to build walls or lay barbed wire. And that counts for something in the light of recent tendency in this part of Europe and the Balkans. I suffer strong attack of asthma after my Middle East experience. Now it's coastal climate, it's very difficult for my lungs. It's some kind of stress test for my lungs, and sorry for this kind of tonality of my voice. On the other hand, this Dayton global touch may be contagious. Perhaps it might be transferable or applicable elsewhere. I find appealing the notion of Bosnia as a carrier of something global, and in that case, it might can speak to its universalism. Unsurprisingly, politics precludes me from further examination of this premise, but I believe that keeping it in mind might be illuminating. Second, I feel we face a plethora of information, analysis, assessment, statistic about the Balkans. Is that enough? Quite contrary. Too much paralysis, too much analysis leads to paralysis. And at the point of paralysis, the sole way out is through the tunnel of intuition. I hope that today you will jointly master sufficient intuitive audacity to help us unveil what is hidden in the midst of the Bosnian and Balkans mountains. Globalization is experimental and uncertain. In Bosnia, we are not magicians, but perhaps we can be a part of positive aspect of global change and make positive magic happen. I see here Mrs. Martin, and I have to just say again, I recall a photograph of Mrs. Martin and her husband, Richard Holbrooke, published, taken some point around the conclusion of Dayton Agreement, and Mrs. Martin and Richard Holbrook just are, they are stepping with determination, and I have a good phrase, in staring to the distance, leaving, in a, leaving an impression that they are off to end the war. This is how we saw it, common people of Bosnia. Common people of Sarajevo, eager for everyday wonders of life, everyday wonders of peace. And we understood then, at symbolic level, because, look, all we Bosnians, we are past master of symbolism, that better times were coming. Times of reuniting scattered families, violently sundered relationships, that the medieval siege of cities were coming to an end, and the time of reopening of the society was coming. This is how we remember you, Mrs. Martin. Of course, Tanya Domi is an indispensable figure who helped bring essential truths to light in Bosnia-Herzegovina after the war. It was so essential to read her views carried by the daily newspaper of Slobodzenje. And I also see Ivana here. I met Ivana, it was May of 2011, it was conference in Sarajevo, and she really delivered outstanding lesson at the Sarajevo School of Political Science. And she was with another young woman, Denisa Saralić-Maglić in that time. Hearing her advocacy of Bosnia-Herzegovina, democratic Bosnia-Herzegovina steeped in the rule of law reinforced by a plethora of valuable insights was a rare and unforgettable treat. And finally, my diplomatic message through Leonard Cohen lyrics is, ring the bells that still can ring, forget perfect offering. There is a crack in everything, that's how the light gets in. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. I was very moved by your remarks, and I share your view that the lessons of Dayton are absolutely applicable in crisis situations, and we seem to have a wide menu of crisis situations to choose from today. Foremost among them, and the one of most concern for me, is the refugee crisis that is engulfing Europe and threatening European stability. May I just be a real bore and ask you to turn off your cell phones? And the minute that I'm done, you can turn them back on. So, Alex, thank you for that amazing introduction. No one has ever listed all my awards. So, wow. I have to go home and polish all of them after this. So, Tanya, thank you so much for inviting me. It's a great honor for me to be with you and with so many friends of Bosnia. Errol, it's a great pleasure to meet you as well, one of the most distinguished journalists covering Bosnia today. So, what I want to do this evening is to take you behind the barbed wire of Wright-Patterson Air Base and tell you what it was like there inside, and to give you a sense of how very close to failure that those 3 weeks were, and how, you know, after 20 years of sometimes precarious peace, but peace nonetheless, it's very easy to say that the success of the Dayton Accords were preordained. Well, let me tell you something, they were not. Many times we came within I say we because Richard Holbrooke was the sort of man who made no separation between his personal life and his diplomacy. And we were newly married that year. It was a terrible year to choose to be married, 1995. And the war in Bosnia shadowed every single day of our first year together. But he wanted me with him. And therefore I was. And therefore I have, I think, a rather unique perspective on what went on at Wright-Patterson. And Richard was the sort of diplomat who believed in using any weapon, any tool to hand. And I was often available. And so he used me. We associate peace treaties with glittering backdrops like Versailles, Paris, Vienna, Geneva. No one ever had Dayton, Ohio on their list of places for an international peace treaty. But it was in this unassuming, very American, Midwestern town that the most savage war since World War II was ended, and a peace was crafted. Today, the United States faces urgent humanitarian and national security threats, as it did 20 years ago. And that peace forged in Dayton really provides, I think, a very useful roadmap out of the crisis that I refer to, and of course it's the refugee crisis, which is threatening European stability, and of course the humanitarian the humanitarian nightmare of the endless, and it will remain endless, human flood that is now crashing against European borders, which, as the ambassador rightly pointed out, are rapidly building walls and fences around themselves, and frankly, I'm deeply ashamed of my own country, of Hungary. I was born and raised in Budapest. I'm a refugee from Hungary. I was a refugee who was treated. I was a little girl when my parents brought me here, and we were extremely well treated by this country that took 200,000 of us, and Hungary today has behaved in an appalling way, and unfortunately the virus of xenophobia and nationalism and racism is spreading from Hungary all the way to Denmark, and it's a dangerous moment for Europe, and the United States has a deep interest in keeping Europe stable, and to be honest with you, I am rather unhappy with the United States' current position on, or lack of position on refugees. We have taken less than 2,000 Syrian, we have granted asylum to less than 2,000 refugees. Germany is going to be up to 1 million by the end of the year. Germany, ironic as that seems, Germany has behaved with greater courage and statesmanship than any other European country. I am not proud of the way the United States so far has shunned its traditional, its historic responsibility and moral stature as a nation of refugees, which we all are. And I would like to call on all of you who are in a position to raise your voices on this subject. To do so, I'm spending a lot of time these days agitating in Washington, and have organized a conference to be held on December 11th on this subject. So, but I think we each need to do our best on this. I'm channeling my dear Richard, who would be all over this subject, because refugees were always at the core of Richard's diplomacy, from the Vietnam boat people to the Balkan refugees, to his last post, Afghanistan and Pakistan. Refugees were always at the core of his diplomacy. And really, our behavior raises the question of what it is that our country stands for. and how many children's bodies need to wash up on Mediterranean beaches before our country says enough. So 20 years ago in the Balkans, 350,000 people had been killed and thousands were forced to flee. It was the first post-Cold War testing of NATO, and NATO's credibility was on the line. I remember my husband during those days being inflamed by what was happening in Bosnia and going there even before he had a public position as a private citizen going to visit the Omarska concentration camp and one of the inmates in Omarska handed him a tiny statue that he had carved from a piece of wood with glass. And it's a beautiful really work of art which shows how the prisoners were forced to stand with their hands behind them and in a posture of despair. And showed it to Richard, and Richard looked at it and handed it back, and the prisoner said, no, take it with you and show them what is happening to us. And so, of course, Richard did, and the New York Times ran a full page on this statue, blew it up, and Richard wrote a piece. That statue stands on my desk today. Mm-hmm. And I wish each and every one of you had a copy of that statue as a reminder of man's capacity for brutality to his fellow man and to his neighbors. So it was that incident which was the what really drew Richard into the Balkan Wars, and he was deeply frustrated at how long it took to get Washington, then as now, to do the right thing. Because the war had been raging for, I think, almost 4 years by the time Richard was deployed by President Bill Clinton. And the deployment was the result of the savage massacre of 8,000 Muslim men and boys, Srebrenica, where I was this summer and was deeply, deeply moved by the people who the survivors. I stayed in the house of a Muslim gentleman whose entire family had been wiped out, but he wasn't bitter. He was a very good host and very welcoming, and was very happy that so many dignitaries from the world over, including President Clinton and Madeleine Albright, were there. And the president of Serbia, who, as you all know, he was stoned by a group of fanatics. But there are always fanatics in every conflict. There are always fanatics who like to keep the flame going. And our responsibility is not to let them prevail. Nations, like human beings, best lead by example, and therefore the United States has to take a more a stronger leadership position today in light of the refugee crisis before we can urge the nations of Europe to do their duty. Right now we're not in a position to do that because we're not leading by example. 20 years ago, Americans were as eager to disengage from international obligations after three major wars and the Cold War, half a century of Cold War, as today, which is why it took so long for us to engage. And unfortunately, it took such a tragic event to get us to do the right thing. After Srebrenica, Richard suffered another catastrophic loss, 6 weeks later, his three closest comrades were killed on the treacherous mountain road, the Mount Igman road to Sarajevo, because it was really an accident of war, because Milosevic and Karadzic refused to give Richard and his team safe passage, and they were determined to get to Sarajevo. And of course, the armored personnel carrier that had Bob Fraser, Nelson Drew, and Joe Kruzel in it tumbled down, and they were killed. And I will never forget the expression midway between despair and anger on Richard's face when he got off the plane, where he had spent the night with his knees jammed against the three flag-draped coffins of his three comrades. He attended the Arlington burial of his comrades, consulted with President Clinton, and got right back on the shuttle. And basically, I didn't see him again until Dayton on November 1st. That's when he brought the three Balkan leaders and to Dayton, and I must tell you that nobody wanted Dayton as the venue for the peace conference. Not President Clinton, Vice President Gore. They didn't want an American peace conference because failure was so assured. There had been 30 attempts at ceasefires and negotiations, all ended in failure. And so success was not at all in the air. And so the Americans didn't want to be that closely linked to failure. Needless to say, the Europeans wanted a European venue, and the Balkans wanted a more glamorous setting, especially Milosevic, who was dreaming of the nightlife and the good shopping opportunities and places other than Dayton, Ohio, which has neither. Dayton appealed to Richard because it was middle American, it was not a fancy place, it was far enough from Washington so that he didn't fear too much White House and State Department intervention, because Richard liked to have free rein. Once the broad outlines of a peace had been agreed on with his commander-in-chief, and he didn't want the media. There were hundreds of reporters, hungry reporters, right outside the barbed wire, but not inside. And he wanted to be in control of these rather hard to control characters. I'm talking about Tudjman, Milosevic, and Izbegovic. And it was basically a form of incarceration. That's what it felt like. The troubles at Dayton began the first night. Richard had organized a ceremonial dinner in this giant hangar. And even before the first course was served, one of the delegates, the Frenchman, Ambassador Jacques Blot, walked out because he had been sniffed by security dogs, as had all of us. But he said that the honor of France had been injured. And so he went back to his barracks. And Richard, of course, said, "I'm not starting without Blot. I'm not starting without France," a key member of the European delegation. So we all sat there waiting for Mr. Blot, Monsieur Blot, to return, which he did. So just to give you a flavor of nothing was going to be easy here. So Richard seated me between, I see we have some pictures there. That's the final happy outcome. But long before that, and there's Richard with Secretary of State Warren Christopher, who was an occasional drop-in from Washington. He seated me between, that's Haris Saladic, of course, and Carl Bildt of the European Union. These, by the way, are all from my personal scrapbook. And there's Richard, happy and telling the president and hugging me at the same time that the treaty is signed. That was a great moment, November 21st. So He seated me between Milosevic and Izbegovic and said, Kati, your job is to make them talk to each other. So I just have to tell you, this was, when I think about Dayton, I think about maps. This was our room, which doubled as a conference room. And those maps covered every surface. And the nights were spent moving. That was our room. So you see, everybody had the same setup. So there was no hierarchical difference. They were called proximity talks, and proximity, there was plenty of proximity. The walls were thin. The corridor between the rooms was about this wide. Our room, Richard's and my, oh, there you see it. There I am with Richard, and that looks like Tom Donlin. And across from our room was the room we called the Nintendo room, which was the favorite, this is in Sarajevo. With Carl Bildt is behind Richard. I recognize a few other members of his team. We called it the Nintendo room because there was this highly classified computer system that the Pentagon had set up where Richard and his team, that's the Nintendo room, where Richard and his team could kind of play fantasy pilots with manipulating a joystick over Bosnian terrain as they moved towns like Prijedor and Brčko and the Posavina corridor, Mostar. These are the names that are engraved in my memory from those days. There's a typical Richard, always in a hurry, rushing, and with good reason. And there's the happy outcome. So even during the ceremonial dinner with which we started, Richard was making a point because he seated Milosevic and Izbegovic, not only with me between them, but with these giant American war machines almost within touching distance from us. So there was a huge B-29 right overhead, and a stealth F-17 fighter. I mean, you could tell, just like that. And the message from Richard to the warlords, if I can call them that, was that if all else fails, we've got these two. So this, he understood that when you're negotiating with the Tony Soprano of Belgrade, You have to take off your white gloves. This was not white gloves diplomacy. On the other hand, there I am trying to make nice with Milosevic, and that's Foreign Minister Satcherbey. Is anybody a good friend of Mo Satcherbey? Great guy, but he got in trouble with Richard. Several times. Maybe I shouldn't tell an indiscreet story, so I won't. But Richard was running a dormitory for badly behaved students. There was a lot of trying to keep people in line and also imposing the rule that no outsiders could come in. And in my capacity in those days as chair of the Committee to Protect Journalists, I got a chance to actually negotiate with Milosevic, because in the middle of the talks, Karadzic's thugs had taken a colleague, David Rode, hostage near Mostar. David Rode was the journalist who first discovered the graves in the mass graves in Mostar. So Karadzic took him hostage, and Richard very kindly halted the peace talks, the negotiations, and said, okay, Kati, see what you can get out of him. And that's Secretary of Defense Bill Perry, who was also an occasional drop-in. So I have to tell you that my little negotiation with Milosevic was successful. David Rode was freed, but I got a sense of the man, and he was not a man to be browbeaten. He really had to be outmaneuvered and managed, but he was a very shrewd operator. He was a real survivor, and negotiating with him was not a matter of just being tough. It was also a matter of outwitting him. And I had the singular pleasure of at times seeing he almost always had this expression of kind of smug petulance on his face. And several times I saw that look of smugness turn to fear when Richard was having one of his explosions. These explosions were not spontaneous, by the way. I'm here to tell you they were rehearsed. He knew when to use that nuclear weapon. So, I'm fast forwarding because what I really want to do is get into a conversation with and hear your questions and hear of what your interests are. But I will tell you that for everybody who participated in these talks, and I was a fringe presence, it really felt like we were a band of brothers. You knew you were participating in a historic event, and it felt like a great privilege, and I think if you would ask any of us, we would tell you that those were the most exhilarating days of our lives on that, behind the barbed wire, on that Ohio air base. It's very rarely that you have that feeling that this is historic. There were moments that were absolutely surreal. For example, I was asked to take Milosevic shopping at the PX, you know, as if this was a normal thing. You know, here was one of the worst one of the worst war criminals in the world, and I was taking him shopping, and then watching Milosevic flirting with the waitress at Paki's Sports Bar. Paki's Sports Bar was the hangout place on the base where we all. That was the most popular hangout place. The second was the Nintendo room across from our room, but. Milosevic called her waitress Wiki. So those are some random memories to give you the human touch. One of my other tasks from the chief negotiator was when he would hit a wall with either of the three leaders, he would say, okay, Kati, take him for a walk and make him talk about his dreams for his children and his grandchildren. And I have to tell you that these leaders were not interested in their children and their grandchildren. They were absolutely invested in war and in holding on to power. And this brought home to me the old truism about how people who make revolution shouldn't be in charge of governance, because different skills are required for governance than for war making. And so I'm afraid I didn't make much progress with on these long walks on the parking lot. We would go round and round because there was no lawn, just a parking lot. So the last few days were an absolute roller coaster ride of close calls and premature celebrations. And Secretary of State Christopher came with a very fine bottle of French wine to celebrate. And before we even finished with the toasts, the peace talks cratered. At that point, because when one would give a concession, another would toughen up. So it was a chess game. At that point, Richard, who understood power and how to use it, instructed everybody on the American team to pack their bags and to put them in front of their room as a sign that Dayton is over, we're leaving. He and his team, Chris Hill, General Wes Clark, and the others, were in the conference room talking about next steps after failure. And I was in our room, and I looked out the window, and there was Slobodan Milosevic on the parking lot by himself. It was snowing. I knew he wasn't out there for fresh air, and there was something in his body language. So without thinking, I rushed out and pulled him into the conference room, and Richard asked everybody to leave except the Secretary of State and Milosevic. And Milosevic, who didn't want the talks to fail, said, "Okay, here's my concession. We can defer Brichko, a highly contested town on the Croatian border, to later." And that broke the stalemate. So the talks, which had been on life support, were now breathing again. And 2 days later, on November 21st, the three parties signed the Dayton Accords. And it was a moment of great relief. Richard never had illusions that peace would materialize on its own overnight. He always felt that the implementation of the accords would have a huge role in the future of Bosnia. He expected his country to stay very engaged, and he also expected that the worst war criminals, namely Mladic and Karadzic, would be arrested. And that did not happen, and that was a source of great distress for Richard. And unfortunately, he died before they were arrested, and I really deeply regret that. His other regret about Dayton was allowing the Serbs to have the Republic of Srpska as their name, because that gave the Bosnian Serbs the illusion that they were an actual autonomous republic, which was never the idea. And he regretted that, but in the fevered back and forth and horse trading, and above all in his absolute commitment to silence the guns, to stop the killing. Because while the killing was going on, nothing could happen. And that has stopped. He would be distressed that his own country isn't more engaged. And he would also be distressed that Dayton, which was never meant to be a straitjacket, it was meant to be a living document, and you cannot have a peace treaty that is a permanent constitution for a new country without updating. So he was working. He was working on an updating, a revival of the accords. Unfortunately, he didn't live long enough to carry that through. But I have to tell you that I was telling the ambassador that I was fortunate enough to go with Richard the summer before he died to Sarajevo. And it was, you know, to walk the streets of that town, which had been absolutely reduced to rubble the last time I was there. You know, I stayed in the Holiday Inn, and the windows were covered in plastic sheets, and people were running for their lives. So to see that city come back to life, so vibrant and such an exciting place again, and to walk those streets with Richard was one of the great moments for me. But I started by saying that the Dayton Accords should be used as a model, as a prototype for other conflict solving. Dayton is by no means a magic wand, but if we relegate it to the history books now, we really would not be honoring what was America's most significant diplomatic achievement of modern times. We did, after all, end a war against Muslims, which is a very proud achievement. I would like very much for the Dayton prototype, which is to say, let's just together summarize what I mean by the Dayton prototype. So you need all-out American engagement, and please don't wait until you have a Srebrenica to come in, because history tells us that it takes four generations to recover from a single act of violence, and therefore let's not wait for that act of violence before we come in. All-out diplomacy backed up by force, because as you know, while Richard was conducting his shuttle diplomacy, we were bombing the bejesus out of them, too. So it was the combination of those Tomahawk missiles and Holbrook on the ground. And here's another thing you need. You need a president who is willing to buck public opinion, who is willing to go up against public opinion, because the minute the Dayton Accords were signed, the Republicans attacked it. Only 36% of the American people were in favor of sending American troops to Bosnia. And without those 20,000 troops, this very fragile new entity would not have lasted in those early years. So these are the things that the lessons that we can draw from this. And you need a president who's not only willing to go up against polling and public opinion, but who is willing to empower and trust his negotiator. Because if Richard wouldn't have had free rein to do what he did, he often compared diplomacy to jazz. You improvise on a theme, but you have to study the man who's sitting across from you. You can't do that. You can't just fly in and fly out. You have to be there. You have to make the human study of who you're up against, and that takes time. You know, shuttle diplomacy is only the first step. You need to be with them. You need to shut out the world and have all parties there. The people that you're negotiating with need to know that the negotiator has the trust of the commander-in-chief, so that there's no way to wiggle out. Holbrook equals Clinton. There's no daylight there. If Milosevic and Tudjman and Izbegovic wouldn't have known that, I don't think that we would have had a peace treaty. So the refugee crisis confronting us today needs this kind of American engagement. Of course, it's a different situation than the war in Syria, which is what has propelled this human flood. Is a different conflict. Every conflict is different, but some of these some of the methods that, were successful in ending the, let's not forget, most savage war since World War II, 350,000 people killed and thousands made homeless. Ending that war, we need to study how that happened, and we need to use it elsewhere. And I had a very small role at Wright-Patterson, but I'm very proud to have had that role. Thank you very much. So, I think we're going to take questions from you if you have them, right, Alex?
That would be great.
Yeah.
So I will ask all of you to use the microphone that's available there, and please line up. And just
So please.
Mr. Ambassador, will you join us? Right.
Just please, Mr. Ambassador. Thing?
No.
Is that, no. Okay.
Okay.
And so I would just only ask you before you ask your question to state your name and your institutional affiliation, because we are producing a record here. I'm going to start with the first question, and I'm you know, I study actually Central Asia and of course its neighbor Afghanistan, and so much of the efforts at reconciliation in Afghanistan was about applying the Bosnia model to Afghanistan and Pakistan. It's another way in which Dayton has become diffused globally. Mm-hmm. I'm curious, what was the guidance for Dayton? Right? What was the guidance for Dayton? If Bosnia was the blueprint for Afghanistan, what was the blueprint for Bosnia? What sources, inspirations, analogies were drawn upon, and did that balance change at all? In what ways?
Well, this is such a good question, Alex, and the fact is that there really wasn't one. Which is why you needed a team, a negotiator, and a team that had a sense of the history of the region, which Richard first got to Bosnia in when he was a teenager. So he was very familiar and absolutely fascinated by the rich history of the region. And at age 18, he stood in the footprints of Princip, the assassin of Franz Ferdinand that triggered the First World War. So he was a student of history, and a student of great diplomats. He read Harold Nicholson's diaries with great care. But there was no framework because, of course, for 50 years, the region was frozen in the Cold War under Tito. And before that, World War II, and before that, a history lacking entirely in democratic traditions and roots. So it was really kind of nation creation, a challenge. He had a great team. Yeah. He really had a great team. So, I wish I could point to a prototype for Dayton, but there was none, which I think makes the achievement of the peace pretty spectacular. And let's not forget that Karadzic and Mladic are in custody, and Milosevic died in custody. And let me tell you something, this is not a man who wanted to be in prison. This is a man who really liked the finer things in life. So for him to be robbed of freedom was not a small thing. So I was happy to see that the president of Serbia has made a gesture of support to the victims of Srebrenica. And we can quibble about too little, too late. You know what? I'll take it. It's better than the opposite.
Great. Thank you. Please.
Yeah.
Use the microphone.
Dario Cepo, University of Zagreb. Thank you for your keynote speech. Let me just ask two questions. Mm-hmm. First one is taking along on the Professor Cooley's question is why did Dayton succeed, whereas many other peace negotiations didn't? So you have had Israeli-Palestinian negotiations mm-hmm. for 7-8 or how many more times just yeah. failing. Why? What was the reason? Was the reason Richard Holbrooke, or was the reason actually the willingness of the parties to end the war, but they just didn't know how to end it? Mm-hmm. And the second question is, you didn't mention President Tudjman rightly, because I think he was a marginal figure during the negotiations. I think most of the negotiations went between Milosevic and Izetbegovic. But Tudjman presented the Dayton Peace Accords as a big triumph of his policy or of his politics. But his critics in the mid 1990s said that he sacrificed interests of Bosnian Croats in order to gain the territories that were occupied in Croatia. So mm-hmm. is that something you're familiar mm-hmm. with? Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, so those are two big questions. Yeah. One, why peace in Bosnia and not in the Middle East? And of course, the Middle East is in flames now. So peace is more remote than ever. And the refugee crisis that we're all facing is a direct result of an inflamed Middle East. So this is not an academic question. And the answer to that defies a short one from me. But obviously, and each situation is different. And I think the combination of diplomacy and force, which were applied in a very systematic way after Srebrenica, and it was heartbreakingly late in the Balkan mm-hmm. day. Think back to the siege of Sarajevo, which we observed nightly on the news, how long it took us, how long it took the world to mobilize. It's enough to drive one to despair when you think, because you know the old line about how had CNN been at the Auschwitz train station, there wouldn't have been a Holocaust. Well, we were watching Sarajevo, and today, if you want to see a beheading, you can see it on YouTube. You can see anything on YouTube. And what has been the net result? How much are people on the streets in Washington and on campuses at Columbia University demanding that we do something to end the human flood? How many more bodies have to wash up on the Mediterranean? So I think each and every one of us has a responsibility. Actually, I feel this very strongly, because I'm a historian of the Holocaust. I've written a number of books about that. I wrote a book about an extraordinary negotiator, a book that Richard used to carry around with him, called Raoul Wallenberg. How many of you have heard of Raoul Wallenberg? Okay. He was the Swedish young man who saved thousands of Jews in the last year of the war. And he was just one guy, but he was determined, and he knew how to bluff, and he was, in some ways, he reminds me of Richard. He didn't play by the bureaucratic rules. He didn't wear a necktie and go to parties. He took chances, and he played all out to save lives. We need more Wallenbergs. We need more Holbrooks too, frankly. But they can't do it alone. They need the support of their president, but also they need the support of their country. And one of the things that Richard got right, I think, which should be a model for young diplomats, is that he knew that he needed Congress, and he knew he needed the media to have support. Holbrooke made more trips to Capitol Hill than any other diplomat in history, because he needed friends on both sides of the aisle, and he also gave, he was on more Charlie Rose shows than any other human being. He did Colbert, he did Jon Stewart. He, not because he was trying to sell himself, but because he knew he needed support. He needed our support. He needed the American people to understand what was at stake. And I find that this is missing today. Nobody's explaining to us. This is why we have to stay engaged in Bosnia, for example, our proudest diplomatic achievement. And no one can say that America doesn't care about Muslims if you look at what we did in Bosnia. So this is a long-winded answer to your question. As to Tudjman, he didn't get everything he wanted, but neither did anybody else. And that is in the nature of diplomacy. You don't come to the table with a settlement. You trade. It's a horse trade. But everybody always wants something, and the negotiator's challenge is to find what it is that this guy wants. And then you don't start off by saying, okay, we don't talk until you do thus and such. We don't talk until you promise to leave office, as President Obama told Assad. Guaranteed that Assad won't leave office won't come to the table. If you tell him before you start the talks that he's done, he's toast. It's kind of diplomacy 101, that you get them to the table. You get them under the tent. And then you start the horse trading, and nobody will ever be 100% satisfied. Nor should they be. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Please.
Hi, thank you very much. My name is Jessie Hironeshova. I'm a visiting student here from Oxford University. I have a question about the other annexes of the Dayton Peace Agreement. So, as you said, it seemed like as if the main leaders from the former Yugoslavia were only worried about power, territory, and the political systems that they're going to create. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering, there still are, though, annexes about refugees, about national monuments, and mm-hmm. so on. Mm-hmm. Who were the main drivers who would be insisting on these clauses? Were those the European leaders that were also present at the conference? So my question also would be, what were the stakes of the Europeans that were at the conference? Mm-hmm. Whether there were some, sources that they will, or some input that they would have in the annexes, and if it wasn't them, who was the one that was insisting on the rest of the human rights clauses that were included in the peace agreement?
Human rights were
very
good question. Human rights were always at the core of the accords. Richard had a human rights guy, John Shattuck, who was going back and forth between Srebrenica, oftentimes, and Dayton. I remember seeing him in the corridors there. So human rights very much, the leadership for the talks, the broad outlines, as opposed to the details. The leadership came from Richard. The agreement, the outlines of the agreement were set between Richard and Ed Clinton when he appointed him. The very general framework. But as to who the individual drivers, Carl Bildt certainly played an important role. I would urge you to read To End a War if you haven't. It's a very good account. And there's another one called The Road to Dayton by Derek Chollet, also great, for the more granular detail, which they can give you, which this evening I thought that what I could best do is tell you what it was like to be, because we don't really get that sense from the history books very often of what sort of daily life inside the Treaty of Versailles or the Treaty of Westphalia or whatever. So that's
true.
Yeah, but yeah. Those books are good. Yes, you have please. A question.
Thank you very much, Yasmin Mijanovic, PhD candidate, York University in Toronto, and also uh-huh. project manager, Friedrich Ebert Stiftung, regional office in Sarajevo.
Oh, great. Oh, lucky you.
Indeed. Well, to that point, I mean, I really appreciated your comments. Very optimistic, and unfortunately, Sarajevo these days is not a very optimistic place, which relates to my questions. One, vis-a-vis Dayton, you were mentioning how towards the end of the negotiations there was some sense that the talks might fail. Could you give us any insight into what was Plan B, if there was a Plan
B? What was Plan B?
And related to that now, of course, the question of the future. You've spoken passionately and very evocatively about changing American policy, not only on Syria and the refugee crisis, but also on Bosnia. The United States, of course, has elections coming up as well. And I mean, in your personal capacity or in your personal commentary, what is it that you would like to see American policy do in Bosnia specifically, 2016 and beyond?
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, bunch of good questions. And are you currently living in Sarajevo?
Yeah.
Oh, wonderful. Well, I'll come and see you next time I come. Thank you. Let me start by outlining what I would like to see the United States do, because I think that we are shirking our responsibility as a strong moral force in the world. And I said that leadership is best done by example, and that you cannot compel people to behave well if you yourself are not. Quite simply. And it's true of human beings, and it's true of nations. So I think the United States has to restore its the sense that we are not about boots on the ground and force, primarily. We are about certain principles, and those principles sometimes require us to use force to back them up, because evil is very real in the world. That's a fairly obvious statement. Evil exists, always has, always will. We can't just be the good guys. But as Hillary Clinton said, we're not Denmark. We're the United States of America. And that comes with certain global responsibilities. I am by no means advocating that we become global policemen. Obviously, the terrible legacy of George W. Bush, which we're all paying for, was that we became gun shy about engaging in wars, which is a good thing. We shouldn't. We are partly to blame for the explosion in the Middle East, frankly. We started an unnecessary war in Iraq, and we have ignored the war in Syria, we can't do that. We can't do that, and we cannot wait for that refugee crisis, which is having political implications in Europe. It is fueling a tendency toward right-wing xenophobia, which is spreading. America has to engage. I'm quite confident that in a Hillary Clinton administration, there would be a more muscular engagement with Europe, because that's who she is. And I think that would be a huge benefit for Bosnia. And I would like to see her husband become, whose proudest diplomatic achievement the Dayton Accords are. Peace in Bosnia is actually not first of all, Bill Clinton's credit. Mm-hmm. He had the good sense to appoint Richard Holbrooke, but it was Clinton who, after Srebrenica, engaged in this way. So, So I'm not a warmonger, on the contrary, but I think America has a role to play. And having just paid a call on the European Union in Brussels, because I did a refugee research trip that took me from Hungary to Brussels, I can tell you that the Europeans can't agree on anything. And that has not changed in 20 years. Those 30 failed attempts at negotiation, 30 before the Holbrooke mission, that was a result of the Europeans not being able to act in concert. And we are seeing that played out today with the refugee crisis. And therefore, I fear that my country, the United States, has got to play a leadership role and help them to find a way. But we can't do that if we only take 1,900 Syrians. So does that make any sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Please.
Hi again, Ivana Cetković-Bajrović from the National Endowment for Democracy in Washington, also currently living in Sarajevo, but originally from Brčko, actually.
Oh, you are?
Yes,
oh,
I am.
Interesting.
So thank you for your work in Dayton. It meant a lot personally.
Yes, I pulled him in from the snow.
I wanted to take an opportunity first to, again, publicly now, thank you for the support that you're giving to Velma Šarić and the team at the Post-Conflict Research Center and the wonderful work with the Ordinary Heroes. You mentioned that you spent some time with the youth that Velma and her team are working with in Srebrenica this summer.
Yes.
And one of the topics that was raised at the end of our previous discussion this evening was about the new generation and
yes.
whether there is hope for Bosnia in the new generation to overcome the difficult legacies of the past. What were your impressions from this trip?
Thank you for your question. I was so impressed by those young people. Actually, I haven't stopped talking about them. Those kids that I met in Srebrenica, they are the hope for your country, Mr. Ambassador. They are not they're not like injured victims. They are really focused on the future, and we have to do everything in our power to support them and to bring them here for training and I can do some of that in media training. Everybody knows something they can do that they can help with. We can't let Bosnia sink into this captive of these feuding forces, a captive of history. We can't let that happen again. There are too many good people there, and you're working with a lot of them. I think the future is theirs. You know what I said about how a single act of violence takes four generations to. I read that in some history book. You know the leaders of Bosnia and Serbia and even Croatia to a lesser extent, they're all still living in the past, and they're still hostage to history, and it will take. I can say the same thing about the leaders of the former Soviet occupied countries, like my own country of Hungary. You know, it takes a war, when a war ends. This is what I've learned. It isn't really over. It's just okay. The shooting stops. But everybody has an injury, and everybody wants to be vindicated, and everybody will tell you that my injury is deeper than his. The wrong done to me was greater than the wrong done to him. And therein lies madness, yep. If we start endlessly comparing injuries. We have to move on from there. And the Balkans are famous for nursing injuries. That's how Milosevic started the war. How old was that? Was the battlefield in the Kosovo fields? 500 years, right? 500 years, and it sparked the war.
So we are running short on time. So what I'd like to do is to collect questions that people might have, and perhaps we can answer them as a group,
sort of
going forward. So please. Yeah.
I just have one question and a comment. One is. My question is, I hope you are personally talking to Hillary Clinton. because from my own experience and many of my colleagues here, I'll lament the withdrawal by the United States in Bosnia.
Yes.
This is a great lament and great regret. This yes. stepping back from engagement, ceding to the Europeans and yes. an ascendant Russia running around.
Yes, I haven't even mentioned that
so,
Russia.
So, and then my last comment and observation that I want to share with you and also my colleagues, because I worked with your husband on a number of occasions. And I just want to say, did he ever do just one thing at a time? Because every time I saw him, he was doing two things, which I observed in these photos. He was on the phone with his arm around you. And my distinct memory of Richard Holbrooke was in July 1997, when he came into imposed the license plates, the passports, and the money,
yes.
The images on the money, and he was walking into the National Museum like this.
Yes.
With two phones. And I thought that was quintessential Holbrooke.
It was,
and,
yes.
And what a great American patriot, thank what a great citizen. He literally died with his boots on. Mm. Thank you very much for sharing what you've shared tonight.
Thank you, Tanya.
Thank you. Thank you. Please, ma'am, we'll take a couple more.
Advisory Council for Bosnia-Herzegovina from Washington, D.C.
Nice to meet you.
You as well. Thank you so much for your remarks tonight and for letting us in the little private world that you lived in those days. I have a question and a bit of a comment. You talked about the situation feeling as if you were negotiating with warlords, warlords trying to come up with some kind of an agreement. From the world I come from, I'll give you a bit of a personal story.
Yes.
I'm from Srebrenica, who lost about 53 members of our family in July
terrible.
Of 95.
I'm so sorry.
How did you, thank you very much. How do you think that the rooms felt? Sometimes I think we run into this, perhaps analyzing this as equalization of blame.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So if we're calling everyone warlords, we don't address the fact that somebody started the war and somebody was
fair enough. Yes.
Was defending their own people.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, I really do hope that you will reconsider the remarks earlier where you called the people in Srebrenica fanatics. Because emotions were really high.
Yes.
I was there, actually,
yes.
right next
yes.
to
Me
the
too.
Mob.
Me too, it was scary.
And it was scary. And that was just a few days after Serbia had asked Russia to veto the genocide resolution at the UN. As we say, it takes four generations to heal from a single act of violence. It will take time for Srebrenica people to not make their peace, because I don't think that's ever coming, but it will take time to move past it in a way where they don't feel so offended by somebody who said for every Serb kill there will be 100 Muslim dead.
Thank you. Thank you very
thank
much.
You very
and let's
much
take one
you.
More here.
Okay.
Very briefly, Anna Di Leglio from the New School and NYU. Did your husband talk during Dayton or later about the fact that Kosovo was not included in the Dayton discussion?
Mm-hmm.
And you said that one of the things that Dayton tells us is we should act diplomatically before genocide happened, but the fact that Kosovo was not included in the Dayton peace talks obviously led to what we all know. So did he ever talk about this during or afterwards? Did he regret?
My memory,
it might have been impossible to include Kosovo, but.
Right, that's precisely my memory of it, that would have been a deal breaker for to get the peace in Bosnia, you couldn't include Kosovo. But you and I would both have to check the transcripts for the precise reason. But I do recall that there was simply no scope for settling Kosovo. But Richard was very active in Kosovo, as you know, afterwards. So tell me your name again. Ansaba. Adisaba. Your loss is beyond calculation, and I'm deeply saddened to hear it, and there's really no way that any of us can ever compensate you for your loss. I don't think that throwing stones is ever an answer to anything. I understand the human impulse, but it simply isn't the way out of anybody's pain. It really just fuels the hate and the sense of hopelessness I wrote a book about the Middle East called A Death in Jerusalem, another book that Richard used to refer to, because it was about the first attempt to negotiate between Arabs and Jews, and it ended with the murder of the assassination of the peacemaker, who was a Swede. And he was assassinated by Jewish terrorists, actually Yitzhak Shamir, became prime minister of Israel some while later. And the lesson that Richard drew from that book, which is called A Death in Jerusalem, I recommend it highly, is that sadly in the Middle East, this gentleman asked about the Middle East. In the Middle East, the zealots always seem to win. So just as this peacemaker was assassinated on the eve of the UN presentation of a peace deal, the Swede, Count Bernadotte was his name, was going to present his plans to the UN the next day. And of course, the zealots, those who did not believe that an inch of Jewish territory should be traded for peace, they killed him. And so the peace died with him, just as the peace died in 95 when Rabin was killed. So we cannot let the stone throwers hold the rest of us, however legitimate their hatred. These Jews who killed the negotiator, they were victims of the Holocaust. They had lost their families to Hitler's ovens. And so they felt absolutely justified in their own minds. But the fact is that we cannot let them rule the day. They will never come around. So we have to acknowledge their pain and their suffering, but not let them determine whether there is peace or war. We can't do that.
Well, I think that's a great note to wrap up tonight. And I think, Cadi Martin, in this study of this most extraordinary of events and negotiations, you have given us the most extraordinary of insights into how it all happened. We're truly grateful for you being here. And I'd like to thank everyone for being here, remind you that the conference will be happening tomorrow morning. I'd like to thank everyone watching at home. Thank you, Ambassador, for your opening remarks, and wishing you all well. Thank you again.
Okay. Thank you.